In a world where most RB26 owners are ditching the stock twin turbos in favour of a big single, the integrated Motorsports R34 GTR is bucking that trend, and they've actually gone back from a big single to low-mounted twins. We're here with Peter from PMC Race Engines to find out why they've made that switch. So, Peter, for a start, this car has been developed over a number of years. Last year when we were at World Time Attack Challenge, it was running a BorgWarner EFR9180. Let's go back to last year. What sort of power were you making on that turbo, and what sort of boost were you running?
Well, the big problem with the EFR is we maxed it out, and it just didn't have any air left at about 950 horsepower. And we really needed to step it up because cars were just getting out of control. And we really wanted 1,200 horsepower, and there just wasn't any single turbo that could pull up a corner and just have no lag and still have that 1,200 horsepower.
So basically, when you're in that BorgWarner EFR range, the 9180, that's the big boy, that's the biggest turbo that BorgWarner produce, and it is rated essentially around that 1,000 horsepower mark. So it's not that surprising that you were basically on the limit at that power level. Now, as you've sort of alluded to there, there are definitely a lot of turbos in the single turbo variety that are capable of much more than 1,000 horsepower. But you had a problem in that the area you wanted to be in, you kind of fell into a grey area in terms of turbo selection?
Yeah, it's so important to have, you know, a snappy throttle response, and you need that throttle to be like a really big NA car as you come off a corner. And the big single just won't do that. Yes, it will have that, you know, 1,200-1,300 horsepower, no problem, you know, with a big Precision or a Garrett, but it just doesn't work on the track. So we had to go to the twins. And when Garrett brought these 660s out, it just changed the game.
All right, so the turbo you've just alluded to there, you're now running a pair of the G25-660s. Now, they're probably 18 months, maybe 2 years into the sort of public release of that G-series turbo, but they are still relatively new, and particularly at the point in time where you guys made the call to go twin G25-660s, there wasn't much data, if any data, out there. So that's a ballsy move. How do you sort of talk us through how you make that call that this is the turbo that's going to work for you?
Well, it's, you know, knowing turbochargers and reading the maps and really searching, you know, for what you, you know, these products. And we do so much R&D that we took a gamble because we didn't know for sure if they were going to be as good as Garrett said they were going to be. And lucky for us, they were. So they really do snap on. And when you push them, they just carry so much top end. At 35 pounds, we're seeing, you know, over 1,200 horsepower at the engine. And yes, just changed the game. There's just absolutely no lag, and it's just like a really big engine.
All right, so you've got 2.8 litres as well feeding these turbos. So it's not a small capacity engine, but still you've only got half of that feeding each turbocharger. So what sort of rev range are you getting out of the G25-660s? Or essentially, I guess the other way of looking at that is, what's your boost threshold? Where are you seeing full boost?
Yeah, look, it depends on where we put our inlet camshaft, but we can have 30 pounds of boost at 6 and over 1,000 horsepower. That's a little bit too violent, and we have to actually back that out a bit to give it drivability off a corner. Otherwise, we have four tyres exploding, you know. But we try to blend the boost in, and we try to make about 1,100 from 7 to 10. We try to roll that through that period, which is a really strong flat torque curve. And it makes it very fast.
I think that's an area that a lot of people overlook. We talk a lot about lag and the downsides of lag, but you know, we're talking there maybe about an engine that's only producing 400, 500, 600 horsepower, where you can put all of that to the ground the second it can make it. But when you're starting to talk about 1,000+ horsepower, there's that fine line between the turbo's hitting so hard that it overcomes the traction available and causes wheel spin. So that's just the area you're sort of talking about there. Getting that fine balance.
Yeah, I mean, without the management systems we have today, we're running the MoTeC M150, and we're using traction and, you know, boost strategies, and it's imperative too, because we're only got a small tire in these cars, and you know, we just blow the tyres clean off them. So we bleed that boost in, and we, each gear we're putting a little bit more in at, with wheel speed, and that's the only way we can get it done.
Now, a comparison that I'm personally really interested in, if you overlaid the boost and the power graphs between the 9180 and the twin G25-660s, who wins? Where's the winner there?
The twins kick ass.
So the twins are better everywhere?
Yeah, they're absolutely fantastic. I surprised myself with them. They just really work. They really come on, and they're on easily 500 earlier than the 9180. And they just draw a line straight over the top of them, 250 extra kilowatts with the same boost.
Okay, so there's been a lot of debate out there in the general GTR community about this twin versus single debate. And the general consensus is, at least in the street, to relatively highly modified GTRs, the single turbo is the way to go. So do you put that down to packaging constraints around the way people are using twin turbos? A lot of them obviously are designed as generally basically replacements for the stock twin turbos, or is it just these G25-660s are that much better than what's previously been available?
Yeah, definitely the technology has improved. Wheel technology has come so far. You know, when you talk about a Dash 5 or a Dash 7 from the past, they're 30 years old. But that's not the whole story. Big singles just got so much better. And, you know, the 35s, the 87, you know, 68, 70s, the 9180s are just fantastic turbos. And they're very hard to beat. But there's that one spot where we need to be able to go a little bit further and still have that drivability. And the twins do that. But the only downside to these big twins is that you really need to run a higher pressure ratio. And that means that you have to drive that wheel very hard. Now, that doesn't work so well for a road car because it's so savage. And you really have to have your tune just so good. Otherwise, it really ends badly.
I will argue that there's potentially one other downside with twins, and that is the packaging. There is a lot going on in that engine bay, and I certainly wouldn't want to have to do any servicing work on that rear turbo. But of course, that is a price you pay. You know you're going to be facing that sort of problem, so it's kind of a given with the twin turbo package. But look, it's always nice when a plan comes together. You've gone and made what at the time was a bold move, going to a relatively untried turbo, and it has worked out for you. There's still a couple of sessions left this afternoon at World Time Attack, and we really wish you guys all the best, and hopefully the car can put down a representative time with that new package. Thanks for the chat there, Peter.
Thank you very much, and we are going to turn it up now, so hopefully it all goes well and Matt can do a real good time.
Best of luck. We'll be right back.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.